Hello everyone, I am Dr. Prashant and in this presentation we will talk about acute kidney injury. Acute kidney injury is defined as a rise of serum creatinine by more than 0.3 milligrams per deciliter in 48 hours or a 50% rise above the baseline over a period of 7 days. Or there could be a urine output less than 0.5 ml per kg per hour for more than 6 hours. Acute kidney injury may either be pre-renal, intrinsic, or post-renal. This classification helps us to understand the mechanism, etiology, and also guides the management of acute kidney injury. Post-renal acute kidney injury generally indicates a pathology in the ureter, bladder, and urethra. Pre-renal acute kidney injury may be due to hypovolemia, decreased cardiac output, decreased effective circulating volume, such as in patients with congestive heart failure and acute liver failure, and impaired autoregulation due to non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, ACE inhibitors, and cyclosporin. Intrinsic acute kidney injury may be due to a pathology in the glomerulus, in which case it is because of acute glomerulonephritis. Intrinsic AKI may also be because of pathology in the tubules or in the interstitium, that is the space around the tubules. And in this case, it may be due to ischemia, sepsis and infection and nephrotoxins, which may be exogenous or endogenous, as we will see later in the presentation, due to contrast medium, aminoglycosides, and hemolysis and rhabdomyolysis as well. Intrinsic acute kidney injury may also be because of anomalies in the vasculature and may be due to vasculitis, malignant hypertension, and TTP-HUS or thrombotic thrombocytopenic purpura, hemolytic uremic syndrome. This is a schematic diagram of the ureter. This is the bladder, the prostate, and the urethra. Abnormalities in any of these structures constitute post-renal acute kidney injury, and this may be because of bladder outlet obstruction, bilateral pelvo-urethral obstruction, or unilateral obstruction in a patient in whom there is a single functioning kidney. When dealing with acute kidney injury, one thing we must all do is learn the salient features of AKI. And these can be studied under the following headings: etiology, clinical features, laboratory features, and remarks. Let us talk about pre-renal azotemia. In clinical features, there may be history of poor fluid intake, bleeding, history of intake of NSAIDs or non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, heart failure. There may be absolute or postural hypotension on clinical examination. The patient may also have features of cirrhosis or heart failure. The lab features of pre-renal azotemia include a bun and creat ratio of more than 20, a fractional excretion of sodium of less than 1%. There may be hyaline casts in the urine sediment with an increased urine-specific gravity. The urine osmolality is generally normal in that it is more than 500 milliosmoles. Per kg. Blood urea nitrogen or BUN elevation out of proportion to creatinine is a major feature of pre-renal azotemia. However, it may also be present in other hypercatabolic conditions like upper GI bleed. The most common modality of treatment of this kind of acute kidney injury is rapid restoration of hemodynamics. Sepsis-associated AKI may present with overt hypotension, but this may be absent in moderate acute kidney injury. Labs in such a patient would generally show a positive culture from a normally sterile site, and urine sediment often contains granular casts, renal tubular casts, and epithelial cell casts. Fractional excretion of sodium may be low early on, but may also be more than 1%. In ischemia-associated acute kidney injury, systemic hypotension with sepsis is the dominant clinical feature, and labs may show a urine sediment which contain granular casts and renal tubular epithelial cell casts. Fractional excretion of sodium is generally more than 1%. This FeNA may be low early on in the disease, as discussed in sepsis-associated AKI. Acute kidney injury may be also due to nephrotoxins. These nephrotoxins may also come from within the body, that is endogenous nephrotoxins. And the example of such conditions include rhabdomyolysis, in which the patient may have had a traumatic crush injury, seizures, or immobilization. And labs will show an elevated myoglobin, creatine kinase, urine heme positivity may be present. The FeNA in this case is typically less than 1%. The next cause of endogenous nephrotoxin is hemolysis. There may be history of recent blood transfusion with a transfusion reaction, and the patient will show anemia, elevated lactate dehydrogenase due to ongoing hemolysis, and a low haptoglobulin level. Fractional excretion of sodium may be low in these conditions, and the patient should generally be evaluated for a transfusion reaction. The next cause of endogenous nephrotoxin causing AKI is tumor lysis syndrome, and the patient may have had received recent chemotherapy and will show hyperphosphatemia, hypocalcemia, and hyperuricemia on lab evaluation. Multiple myeloma may also cause AKI, and the clinical features include an elderly male or female with constitutional symptoms and bone pain, and the laboratory features include M spike in the urine or serum, electrophoresis, and a low anion gap. Diagnosis of myeloma would require bone marrow and renal biopsy. Acute kidney injury may also be because of nephrotoxins that are foreign to the body in that they are exogenous. Causes include contrast nephropathy, and historically the patient may have undergone a contrast-enhanced computed tomography scan. There is a characteristic course of rise in serum creatinine within 1 or 2 days, and the fractional excretion of sodium is generally less than 1%. Tubular injury due to antineoplastic agents, antibiotics, and tenofovir may also cause a rise in serum creatinine over 1 to 2 days, and the fractional excretion of sodium is again less than 1%. Interstitial nephritis may have a preceding history of recent medication and also have fever, rash, and arthralgia. Laboratory features include eosinophilia, sterile pyuria, and the patients are often non-oliguric. Urine eosinophils has a limited accuracy in diagnosis of interstitial nephritis, and renal biopsy may be required in such patients. Other causes of intrinsic AKI include glomerulonephritis and vasculitis, and the patients may present with history of skin rash, arthralgia, sinusitis, or hemoptysis, and evaluation should include an anti-nuclear antibody, ANCA, anti-glomerular basement membrane antibody, and evaluation for hepatitis. Intrinsic AKI may also be because of interstitial nephritis, as already discussed. Non-drug related causes include Legionella infection. The patient may again have eosinophilia and sterile pyuria, and kidney biopsy may be required. TTBHUS may also present with neurological abnormalities and AKI with the background of a recent diarrheal illness, and this is specific to hemolytic uremic syndrome. Laboratory features may show cystocytes on peripheral blood smear and an elevated LDH, denoting ongoing hemolysis. Post-renal acute kidney injury may be preceded by a history of kidney stones and obstructed bladder or the use of catheters. Laboratory features include non-specific findings, and the patients may have pyuria or hematuria, and diagnosis would depend upon imaging with ultrasound or computed tomography. Let's move on to a stepwise approach to acute kidney injury. Diagnosis of acute kidney injury would depend upon history and physical examination, urine analysis, lab findings, radiological evaluation, kidney biopsy, and novel biomarkers. In history and physical examination in acute kidney injury, pre-renal AKI is suggested by preceding history of vomiting, diarrhea, and polyuria. Examination might reveal orthostatic hypotension, a reduced skin turgor, and dry mucous membrane. The history and physical examination in intrinsic AKI would generally indicate use of drugs or recurrent sinusitis, suggesting a vasculitis. There may also be on examination a palpable purpura, which suggests a vasculitis, livido reticularis, which suggests an emboli, and erythematous rash, which may be present in acute interstitial nephritis. The history and physical examination in post-renal AKI may constitute history of colicky pain, nocturia, or frequency, and examination might reveal prostatic disease, nephrolithiasis, and pelvic or para-aortic malignancy. Urine analysis is an important part of the evaluation of acute kidney injury. The first point is volume, and patients with aminoglycoside toxicity or with a pre-existing nephrogenic diabetes insipidus may be non-oliguric, and this is important because we cannot diagnose AKI always based on the volume criteria. Protein loss is generally less than 1 gram per day, however higher values are also possible. Hematuria and pyuria suggests acute glomerulonephritis. urinary tract infection, and obstruction. Casts and sediments may also be used for the diagnosis of AKI. In general, muddy casts would suggest an acute tubular necrosis, and RBC casts would suggest acute glomerulonephritis. Additionally, WBC casts are seen in interstitial nephritis. Urine eosinophils are seen again in interstitial nephritis, but also in pyelonephritis and cystitis. Ethylene glycol toxicity may show oxalate crystals in the urine. Uric acid crystals are seen in tumor lysis syndrome. And as already mentioned, muddy casts are seen in acute tubular necrosis and RBC casts in acute glomerulonephritis. Lab abnormalities in acute kidney injury include a raised serum creatinine, but this may show a delayed rise with aminoglycoside toxicity. Peripheral eosinophilia in the lab workup can suggest interstitial nephritis, polyarteritis nodosa, or Churg-Strauss vasculitis. Anemia is generally present in AKI and is multifactorial due to hemolysis and other pathological processes such as thrombotic microangiopathies. Electrolyte abnormalities such as hyperkalemia, hyperphosphatemia, and hypocalcemia may also be present. The other lab abnormalities include creatine phosphokinase and uric acid, which may be elevated in rhabdomyolysis and tumor lysis respectively. An increased anion gap is seen in ethylene glycol poisoning. A low anion gap is seen in myeloma, and complement levels may be used to diagnose glomerulonephritis or vasculitis. Laboratory findings can also diagnose based on the anti-nuclear antibody various autoimmune conditions. ANCA can suggest granulomatosis with polyangiitis. Anti-GBM antibody can suggest good Pasteur's disease, and cryoglobulins may be used to diagnose cryoglobulinemia. Renal failure indices such as elevation of blood urea nitrogen is generally disproportionate to the creatinine rise in acute kidney injury. The next renal failure index is fractional excretion of sodium, and this represents the fraction of filtered load of sodium and is generally less than 1% in pre-renal azotemia due to avid sodium retention. A low fractional excretion of sodium is suggestive of, but not diagnostic of, intravascular fluid depletion. Urine osmolality is generally more than 500 milliosmoles per kg in pre-renal azotemia, suggesting a functional kidney. Imaging in acute kidney injury may also provide clues to diagnosis. An ultrasound or CT may detect obstruction and may present with dilatation of the collecting system along with hydroureteronephrosis. Ultrasound or CT may also show retroperitoneal fibrosis or encasement with a tumor. Antrograde or retrograde pyelography may be used if the diagnosis isn't clear. A word of caution about kidney size in chronic kidney disease. In general, the kidney is small and contracted in CKD, except for cases with diabetes, HIV-associated nephropathy, and infiltrative disorders such as amyloidosis, along with myeloma, may present with a normal-sized kidney, although the patient has chronic kidney disease. A kidney biopsy is an important part of the diagnostic evaluation of acute kidney injury. After a history and clinical examination, we can get valuable definitive diagnostic and prognostic information from the biopsy report. During a kidney biopsy, we must consider the following diagnoses, such as acute glomerulonephritis, vasculitis, interstitial nephritis, myeloma, hemolytic uremic syndrome, and allograft dysfunction. The newest craze in nephrology are the biomarkers in acute kidney injury. These may be classified into either glomerular injury markers or tubular injury markers. The glomerular injury markers may be further subclassified into those in the serum and in the urine. In the serum, we have blood urea nitrogen, cystatin C, and beta trace protein. In the urine, we have podocyte count, podocalyxin, and nephrin. The biomarkers of tubular injury include interleukin 18, kidney injury molecule or KIM, liver type fatty acid binding protein, neutrophil gelatinase associated lipocalin or NGAL, alpha microglobulin, TIMP2, IGF-BP, N-acetyl glucosaminidase, nephrin, and glutathione S-transferase. The complications of acute kidney injury include uremia, hyper or hypovolemia, hyponatremia, hyperkalemia, acidosis, and hyperphosphatemia and hypocalcemia. There may also be bleeding, infection, cardiac complications, and malnutrition, secondary to acute kidney injury. The management of acute kidney injury includes optimization of hemodynamics, and this includes volume resuscitation and judicious use of vasopressors. Elimination of all nephrotoxins must be undertaken, and renal replacement therapy must be initiated as advised. We will discuss certain additional points about the management of acute kidney injury. In patients with rhabdomyolysis, aggressive IV fluid resuscitation and forced alkaline diuresis must be carried out. In patients with tumor lysis, IV fluids along with allopurinol or rasburicase is indicated. Patients with volume overload can be managed with salt and water restriction, diuretics, and ultrafiltration. Hyponatremia may be managed with restriction of free water intake, minimization of hypotonic saline. Hypertonic saline is rarely needed in AKI-induced hyponatremia. Hyperkalemia may be managed with restriction of dietary potassium intake, discontinuation of potassium-sparing diuretics, loop diuretics to promote potassium loss, insulin, 10 units along with 50 ml of 50% dextrose is used to push the potassium into the cell. Salbutamol inhalation, which is beta-2 agonist therapy, is also used, and calcium gluconate to stabilize the myocardium. Metabolic acidosis is treated with sodium bicarbonate if the pH is less than 7.2. Administration of other bases such as THAM may also be considered. Renal replacement therapy is the definitive management. Patients with hyperphosphatemia may be managed with restriction of dietary phosphate intake. Phosphate binding agents such as calcium acetate, sevelamer and aluminium hydroxide may also be used. Hypocalcemia may be managed with calcium carbonate or calcium gluconate if the patient is symptomatic. Hypermagnesemia is managed with discontinuation of magnesium containing antacids. For hyperuricemia, acute treatment is required only in cases of tumor lysis syndrome. Nutritional support with sufficient protein and caloric intake to avoid a negative protein balance is advised. And finally, careful attention must be given to drug dosing and frequency of administration of drugs. That's it for our presentation on acute kidney injury. Thanks for watching, and we will see you in the next video.